Hello, everyone. Welcome to the beautiful Wiltern Theater. I'm Claudia Bester. I'm the Director of Public Programs at the Hammer Museum. Welcome to today's activism training workshop, Stand Up and Fight Back. Tactics and Strategies for Effective Creative Activism with Nadine Bloch and Reverend James Lawson. I am very, very grateful to the Wiltern and to the wonderful staff at Live Nation for letting us have today's special event here in their gorgeous, historic venue. This is an Art Deco masterpiece. I would say truly a crown jewel in Los Angeles' architecture, built in 1931, and I really want to thank Sylvia, Tim, Kaylee, Rick, and Reed for being such incredibly gracious and generous hosts. So some of you might be wondering, why is the Hammer Museum having an activism workshop? What does that have to do with art? Well, there's lots of reasons. First and foremost, the arts have always been inextricably intertwined with social and political issues, and art is created by people whose lives are likewise inextricably intertwined with the social and political environment they inhabit. So perhaps a better question might be, how could you ever separate them? The Hammer Museum has a clear mission that's a litmus test for everything we do. We believe in the promise of art and ideas to illuminate our lives and build a more just world. Programs like today's gathering are a way to bring people together, to feel our way forward, and exchange ideas for building the world we want to live in. Also, the Hammer is part of UCLA, whose primary purpose as a public university is the creation, dissemination, preservation, and application of knowledge for the betterment of our global society. Some people in the White House might not think so, but that is what we're about. UCLA is committed to open access to information and freedom from intolerance, among other things. Together, the UCLA and the Hammer are a community of people that are enriched by the diverse perspectives we live in this wonderful city. So if you want to find out more, you can always check out the Hammer's website at www.hammer.ucla.edu. Now on to today's program. Americans used to know how to organize muscular mass movements for social and economic justice, and we can do this again. But it's going to require a strategic, concerted, well-choreographed, organized movement. It's going to take all of us rolling up our sleeves and doing the work. And we need to go and study some of the lessons of past successful movements to remind us how it's done. To this end, we've invited two of the most successful American activists of the past 50 years to teach us. These nonviolent methods are far more powerful than violence and much, 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 much more effective in the long term. And they work for whatever kind of movement or cause you care about, small or large, from your neighborhood to the nation. So whether you're worried about immigration, the environment, LGBT issues, nuclear weapons, local schools, taxes, or bike paths in your own neighborhood, all of the techniques and strategies you'll hear about today can be scaled up or scaled down to make your message heard. So now I'm going to introduce our trainers. Nadine Bloch is currently the training director for the nonprofit organization Beautiful Trouble. She's worked in social justice and environmental justice movements since 1980 as an organizer and coordinator of creative nonviolent direct action campaigns, both locally and internationally, marine and land-based. Her experience includes myriad of innovative nonviolent actions and facilitating workshops in nonviolent action, as well as political performance, street theater, puppet construction, prop construction, earned media, strategic campaign planning, and more. She has a degree in environmental studies and politics and many years as a formal and as an informal educator. And she's worked with diverse organizations including the Ruckus Society, NOAA, Greenpeace, NOW, Business Leaders for Sensible Priorities, Labor Heritage Foundation, Nonviolence International, Health Gap and Housing Works, as well as with Bread and Puppet Theater. She was once described by Mademoiselle magazine as a female James Bond because she's caused all kinds of beautiful trouble in some very experimental and creative ways. She's a contributor to the book Beautiful Trouble, as well as the book We Are Many, Reflections on Movement Strategy from Occupation to Liberation, and has a regular column on the website wagingnonviolence.org, her column's called The Arts of Protest. The Beautiful Trouble book is a really wonderful resource that fleshes out a lot of the messages you'll hear the taste of today, and I highly recommend it, and we have copies available in the lobby in case you want to take one home tonight. Our second teacher today is Reverend James Lawson, who remains one of the most important social justice leaders of our time and a major hero of mine. Reverend Lawson is an American activist and university professor. He was a leading theoretician and a tactician of nonviolence within the civil rights movement. During the 1960s, he served as a mentor to the Nashville Student Movement and the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and to this day, he continues to train activists in nonviolence. As a freshman at Baldwin-Wallace College in Ohio, he joined the Congress of Racial Equality, also known as CORE, an organization affiliated with the Fellowship of Reconciliation. Both CORE and the Fellowship advocated nonviolent resistance to racism. Consistent with those principles of nonviolence, he declared himself a conscientious objector and refused to report for the draft in 1951. He served 14 months in prison after refusing to accept neither a student deferment nor a ministerial deferment. So he could have gotten out, but he said, nope, I'm going to stay in prison because I am a conscientious objector. After his release, he went as a Methodist missionary to India, where he studied the principles of nonviolent resistance that Mohandas Gandhi and his followers had developed. He then returned to the US in 1955, entered the Graduate School of Theology at Oberlin, where one of his professors introduced him to Martin Luther King Jr. Martin Luther King Jr. had just led the Montgomery bus boycott in Alabama and also embraced Gandhi's principles of nonviolent resistance. And King urged Lawson to move to the South. Lawson then moved to Nashville, Tennessee, and enrolled as a graduate student in the Divinity School at Vanderbilt, where he served as the Southern Director for CORE and began conducting nonviolence training workshops there for the SCLC. While in Nashville, he met and mentored a number of young students at Vanderbilt, Fisk University, and other area schools in the tactics of nonviolent direct action. And in 1959 and 1960, he and the activists he trained launched the Nashville Lunch Counter Sit-ins to challenge segregation in downtown stores. And through this work, they successfully desegregated all Woolworth's lunch counters. Along with activists from elsewhere in the South, they formed the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in 1960. His students then went on to play leading roles in the Freedom Rides, the 1963 March on Washington, Mississippi Freedom Summer, the Open Theater Movement, the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, the 1963 Birmingham Children's Crusade, the 1965 Selma Voting Rights Movement, the 1966 Chicago Open Housing Movement, and the Anti-Vietnam War Movement over the next several years. He was expelled from Vanderbilt as a result of these activities, which then became one of the celebrated incidents of the era, and eventually a source of deep embarrassment to the university. During the 2006 graduation ceremony, Vanderbilt apologized for its treatment of Reverend Lawson, and he's now a member of its faculty. After Nashville, Lawson pastored the largest African-American Methodist church in Memphis and continued to work closely with Martin Luther King Jr. in Birmingham and on other civil rights campaigns, teaching workshops in nonviolence. In 1968, when black sanitation workers went on strike for higher wages and union recognition after two of their co-workers were accidentally crushed to death, Reverend Lawson served as chairman of their strike committee. He invited Dr. King to Memphis in April 1968 to dramatize their struggle, which had adopted the slogan, "I am a man." Dr. King delivered his famous mountaintop speech in support of the strike in Memphis on April 3, 1968, the day before his assassination. Later, Lawson moved to Los Angeles in 1974 to lead Holman United Methodist Church in the West Adams District, where he served for 25 years before retiring, and I say retiring in quotes because he certainly has not retired, but allegedly retired in 1999. He's continued to train activists in nonviolence and to work in support of a number of causes, including immigrants' rights in the United States and the rights of Palestinians, opposition to the war in Iraq, and workers' rights for a living wage. In 2004, he received the Community of Christ International Peace Award. He's been spearheading a new initiative in civil discourse and social change at Cal State Northridge as a visiting faculty member. He also teaches at UCLA and at Vanderbilt University, and also continues to teach his ongoing workshops in nonviolent social justice organizing at Holman United Methodist Church. And there's a new book that came out last year about Reverend Lawson, and we have copies of that also available in the lobby. So today, this dynamic duo is going to lead us in an instructive workshop on all the different kinds of beautiful trouble you can start within a nonviolent direct action framework. We'll have a 15-minute break in the middle. And then after the program ends at 6 p.m., we'd like to invite you all to stay and mingle in the lobby for another hour, if you like. We've invited several nonprofit activist organizations to come and have tables in the lobby. So please feel free to visit them and speak with their staff, and maybe you'll match up with an organization you want to become more involved with. So now, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Nadine Bloch and Reverend James Lawson.
Thank you. Well, thank you all. Thank you all for coming. We're really glad you're here today. I think you're getting a standing ovation from some people. That's okay.
Thank you.
It's great. So we're really glad you're here, that you've decided to join us on this Sunday afternoon. We're really, really thankful for the Hammer for inviting us to do this and in the moment actually stepping up to the plate to help people get mobilized. And we're really thankful for the Wiltern also for hosting this. And we'll do some more later with all of you. So just by way of starting, I guess, we wanted to, I'll tell you a little bit about what we're starting with. Can we go to the slides? We have a few slides because this is actually a workshop setting, not a rock and roll show. And we're gonna talk a little bit about what we're doing here today to give you, to put it in place. So this is maybe this much of a possible field of nonviolent action trainings and workshops and education that you could take. We're really glad that you've decided to join us for that, but take a look at this slide and you'll see that it could encompass everything from legal support to how to deal with trauma to police liaison training and of course political education and a huge spectrum of things. Do you want to add anything, Jim, to this? Keep going. So one of the things that we did talk about though is that often we do trainings that are focused on specific preparation for particular events. And in this case, we're doing a generalized introduction to nonviolent action and nonviolent principles.
And I would say that in my own judgment, most of us raised in the United States and enamored by the United States do not have an understanding of nonviolent struggle or of nonviolence, and we do not have a grasp of the history and the theories and the many kinds of methods and tactics. Now, when I first decided I was a nonviolent practitioner in 1947-48, there were very few books on the subject, per se. Today, now, I have more than two pages in terms of listing the books that are available. And I could add to that the biography of significant names from across the world, in fact, that would probably double that list very, very quickly.
Right, so we're really glad you're here today. We hope that one of the things you take away is that there's so much more to study, so much more to learn, and there's so many things to learn from our ancestors and the movements that have come before us. And we'll just really quickly, because it is a workshop, review the agenda. Just generally, we're gonna do a bit of a dive into the history and philosophy and principles of strategic nonviolent action. And we're gonna do some active role plays. It's very unusual for me to participate in a lecture type situation as a training. So we really appreciate those people who got little green cards and are gonna step up and be part of the role plays on stage. And there will be a chance after the break to do it, hopefully to do another role play. So if you're looking to get real experience, we really encourage you to join us for that. So we'll be doing some talking, a slideshow, some role plays. We'll take a break. We'll come back and do some more role plays. And we will also then have a chance to talk to Reverend Lawson about more specific advice and lifting up the things that we haven't covered so far today. And before we do our closing, sound good? All right. So, Yeah, we can turn the lights up a little bit more if that's possible. We'd love to see each other better in the audience, but I think, yeah, that's great. Hi. In fact, one of the things, I don't like to do workshops when we don't actually introduce each other. We don't have the time to introduce each other completely, but what I would invite you to do on the count of three, we'll count to three together, is yell your name out so that we can actually meet each other. Are we ready? Here we go. One, I don't hear you. Two, three. Nadine! Thank you. Nice to meet you all. Thanks for coming. All right. So we're at the point where we're going to do, we'd like to invite you all to turn to the people sitting next to you or someone behind you or near you, and we want to give you a couple minutes to talk to each other about why you're here. Why did you come today? Why are you here? What does it mean for you in this moment to be present? So if you wouldn't mind, we're going to give you a couple minutes. Go ahead and turn to somebody near you or turn around, particularly somebody you don't know well, and tell them why you're here. I'm just throwing this. All right. So if you can hear me, when I say people, you say power. People. People. Awesome. Thanks for taking a moment to talk to each other. And if we could have quiet, well, this is an experiment. We really, really are inviting people to join us. It might be one of the larger trainings ever. So we're going to need some agreements on how to focus. So what do you think? If you see somebody, if everybody can put their left fist in the air, if you see somebody with their left fist in the air, it's time to put your left fist in the air also and to be quiet. Does that work? Awesome. So we're going to take a moment. We have Chelsea, who's a Beautiful Trouble staffer, assisting us. She's got a microphone. What we'd like to do is ask if somebody would like to share something that they just heard from their partner about why they're here. Or something that resonated, or something that was surprising. Anybody want to share something? Raise your hand, and we'll try to get to you. Anybody want to share one of the things that they were thinking or shared about why they're here? Yeah. Great. If you could stand up, that would be great.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello. I spoke to Kalea next to me, and we had pretty similar reasons for being here, where we have been engaged personally, but we have a lot of friends who find themselves also to be upset with current events, but we want to learn how to be more of a leader and get our peers engaged as well.
Great, thanks. Anybody else want to share something about why they're here, a particular reason, what motivated them to come today?
My name's Naomi. I was talking to John, and I'm an old, you know, activist marcher for a million years because I'm that old. But John was moved to action the first time since the election of Trump and went to the Women's March, et cetera, and is looking for ways to change the world. And I was I said part of the reason I came is when I first felt the world should be changed in the early 60s. In civil rights and the war in Vietnam, we felt if we could just let people know what was going on, then, and they understood, then things would be all right. And it's not so simple anymore as that. So that's what I'm sharing.
Great, thank you. So Reverend Lawson, do you want to share a little bit about maybe why you're here or what you're thinking about this moment?
I'd like to say, first of all, that you may not change the world if you yourself have not changed. And we're going to put that on the line very clearly. There's a Talmudic thought coming back from maybe 2,000 years ago, 2,300 years ago, that says to save a life is as though to save the world. And that the beginning of saving a world is to save a life. So I'm going to push very hard this afternoon on the notion you're concerned for the world and for especially our own country, the beginning place of change is in ourselves. To do the work that we need to do so that we can take our consent away from the world in which we live. Take it away from the powers that rule, the economies that rule, the powers that make the decisions. Because the world as it is today is not of the choosing of the people of the earth. Gandhi, who coined the term nonviolent struggle, civil resistance, nonviolent conflict, said that the agenda of the people of the world is very different from the agenda of the oil companies and the agenda of the banks and the agenda of most nations. That most people are more concerned for their own well-being, for the well-being of their children, for their neighborhood, for their intimate extended families, for an environment that allows them to do their work and to nurture themselves and to nurture the lives of others. So that is really the agenda of some billions of us in the world. And what we see going on in media is the agenda of the way of the broken powers, the powers without soul, without heart. That's the world that we are listening to and hearing in many instances. So one of the things that nonviolence means to me is to begin to see yourself as an authentic center of the life of the universe, a central gift of God, if you would, and that therefore it's a life that is critical. And to possess it and to explore its possibilities and let it become what you're capable of becoming even at age 88 and a half. Is critical.
That's great. Excellent. And I'll just say one thing that in addition to this bigger framing that Jim put out for us so beautifully, that after the election, I met a lot of particularly white middle-class folks who thought that, oh my gosh, this is the worst ever. How could this election have happened? And I want to say very clearly that I understand and as an activist for a long time, and as someone who works in many different communities, it has been really bad for a lot of people for a long time. And while I'm really happy that some white middle-class folks are waking up now, it's very important that we all step into the work of it. Not just wake up, but actually step into and find the people to work with to change the systemic problems that have made life as a black person, as a trans person, as a black trans person extraordinarily difficult for a long, long time. And so I welcome everybody that's come in today to explore nonviolent action with us and nonviolence, and we'll talk a little bit more about the whole frame of that. But in this particular moment, I find it's really critical and inspiring that people are willing to step into this. So I have a direction. If we could have the slideshow up, that would be really great. I didn't realize if it was up or not. Great. So we just used a whole bunch of different words in this framing. And we're going to now show a bunch of different slides of examples of nonviolent resistance, civil resistance, satyagraha from all over the world. It's been used widely by every kind of person on the planet, across the globe, and for many different reasons and over history. Just to start off maybe a little bit about definitions. It's really important when you work with a community that you agree on what you're calling things or what you mean by words. So for example, when I say civil disobedience, I personally mean breaking an unjust or immoral law. Many people use the word civil disobedience now to mean any kind of resistance action. Doesn't really matter as long as your community agrees on your definitions. So I'm just telling you that's how I use the word currently. The other thing is that we're really here today to talk about nonviolent action, which is strategic use of people coming together, ordinary people coming together to wield their collective strength without resort to violence. which is slightly different than nonviolence, and nonviolence being a principled, moral, or ethical belief that guides your whole life. You don't have to have nonviolence as your principled, moral, personal belief system to engage in strategic nonviolent action. And so while Reverend Lawson has very clearly talked about the benefits of doing that, it's not something that we insist on within the parameters of strategic nonviolent action these days. So just as a way of understanding, a lot of the examples that we're going to use are about, some of them are about principled nonviolent campaigns, and some of them are about strategic nonviolent action, which is the very intentional use of escalated tactics over time. Do you want to add anything about that? Yes.
Well, you and I may disagree here.
Okay, yes.
All right. Gandhi is the one who coined the term nonviolence, and he coined it around 1906 in South Africa. And I'll try not to go into great detail about this, but there were a lot of terms available because there were a lot of different forms of people's actions going on in Europe and Great Britain, in Africa itself. He did not like any of those terms as he organized the Indian immigrants against the racism that the British Dutch Empire had put upon them in South Africa. He did not like the term pacifism. He did not like the term non-resistance. He did not like the term moral resistance. He did not like the term that was used in Great Britain, passive resistance. So none of the language that he heard and read about of direct action by people did he like. So he writes in a book called The Second Volume of Nonviolence in War and Peace, published in 1942. He says there, I coined the term nonviolence, and there are 2 points about that. And I'm a stickler for our listening to him at that point. He translated a word from a religion that he admired, ahimsa, and translated it as meaning nonviolence. Up until that time, ahimsa was translated as non-injury, no harm, an ancient principle of Jainism that has been a part of Hinduism. Then he says, secondly, that by nonviolence, I mean love in action, love practiced, love that permeates every form of behavior and social endeavor. And he said also in that same place, that it's like the love of God. It's agape love. It is the recognition that human life has a dignity to it. The Hebrew scriptures say that human life was made in the image and likeness of God. If you don't like the term God, then say that human beings were made in the image and likeness of life itself. And that no other species that we know of has that quality to their life. So that's Gandhi. So I happen to think that because he coined a term and used it in his own 50 years experiment, that we should try to translate it in our own time in a very precise manner from him. Because I call Gandhi the father of nonviolence. I don't mean by that he invented it, because he saw that it was very ancient, it was in many biographies, it was across written history, but never collected, never brought together. So he calls nonviolence at one place a social science of bringing about change.
Perfect. That's great. Thank you. So if we could bring the slides up again, that would be really great. And we can just have the slides, I think. So here's a great picture from Estonia, the Singing Revolution, where fully a quarter of the population actually joined in resisting the Soviets by singing. It's a really wonderful story if you want to look into that. One of the really interesting things to talk about is where governments get their power from. And in the social view of power, governments get their power from us, from the people that give them consent to be governed. And if we withdraw our cooperation, then they no longer have power over us to govern. And one of the ways of thinking about it is as if it was a structure, a building where the regime or the status quo, the government, is the roof, and that the pillars that hold up this roof are institutions that are made up of people. And if we reach the people in those pillars, whether it's the military, the educational system, the banking system, the media, if we can reach those people in the pillars, then we can take support out from underneath the system itself. And the system will, in some way, be impacted and potentially eventually disintegrate or collapse. So that's one of the things that's really critical to understand about why we think people power is important. And we've already talked about Gandhi, but in this particular instance, we're focusing on the fact that there are two huge categories of nonviolent action. One where we call it obstructive or challenging behavior, and one where we call it constructive behavior. And it is an example of this work of putting in place the future that we want by, in this case, spinning our own cloth in violation or to get around the British tax around cloth, as Gandhi did. This is one of the big categories of nonviolent action. And in particular, when we look at sort of the history of nonviolent action and how people have written about it, a man named Gene Sharp in 1972 cataloged 198 methods of nonviolent action in three big categories: protest, non-cooperation, and intervention. Now, those categories don't take into account or don't emphasize the constructive program, although it's in there, so I always like to mention that specifically. And to also, there's a big category, a fifth category that we talked about many years ago, which is organizational capacity building, or the ability to actually, the willingness to put energy into developing the organizations that make us sustainable and make us sustainable at continuing activism over time, doing trainings, building up communities, and things like that. So those are the big areas that we want to talk about. This is another example. On the screen, you can see the Women's Suffrage March. Really amazing, really. Back in 1913, the women collected more than a million signatures to call for suffrage. There wasn't an internet or anything. And this was a very creative form of petition delivery with all of the names on the placards where they were marching. Do you want to add anything about this example?
The struggle of women to gain the vote in the United States represents how obdurant and blindly stubborn power structures can be, because it took them from 1836 till 1920, they struggled before they got the 19th Amendment. Many ups and downs. And I used that example of the women's suffrage movement also as an illustration of how really tough the American imagery of itself as an enlightened, accessible nation, how very obdurant that is. Mm. That even after, you know, a nation that organizes itself around the necessity of people voting, we do not extend that vote to more than half of the human race, and in our own population, even after a great deal of agitation, yeah, and 80, 90 years.
This is one of the big lessons, actually, persistence. And I think we've seen that recently as well. Mm-hmm. So, and just while we're talking about it, there are these giant, these pictures of masses of people. We just saw a creative petition delivery. This is an occupation in Tahrir Square. And this is a really clear example of when the people withdraw their cooperation or their consent from the government is directly impacted and disintegrates. One of the key things is that we find that it's really critical. This is one of the reasons why nonviolent action is powerful. The more and more people can be resilient and they can withstand oppression or repression of the regime, and the movement grows, then the impact grows as well. It's really important. You want to say something about Mother Jones and the Children's Crusade? Go ahead, okay. I have some water, I can get it. So anyways, one of the reasons why we put this picture in here was to talk a little bit about the labor movement. And one of the things that you can take away is that even though, that one could argue that even though violence changes things in the moment, it certainly destroys the environment, kills people, makes immediate change happen. The thing that actually has changed how we relate to each other, how the social movements or how we relate to each other in our ordinary lives is all about nonviolent resistance. And in the United States, one of the most progressive forces for change has been the labor movement in general. It's the reason why we have 8-hour work days. It's the reason why we don't have child labor. This is an example from Mother Jones's March for Children. This is an example for, funeral in South Africa that turned into a demonstration. And we'll talk a little bit more about it in the second half of this slideshow around how we can use ritual to actually make great impact in our activism work.
And this event also recognized the creativity of a movement, because the government of South Africa insisted that they had emergency laws that outlawed any kind of assembly and so forth and so on. And so it became the case in the 80s especially that a funeral service where they were burying people who maybe had been shot by the police in the townships, and where they might fill a football stadium, what we call soccer, a football stadium, those massive gatherings of 100,000 people became demonstrations against the apartheid government. And this is a good picture of one of them.
Would you like some water?
No, I've got some. Okay. Thanks.
Great. So we're just going to quickly look at it, too. We have found also that nonviolent movements are about twice as effective as violent movements. This new data has analyzed over 100 violent and nonviolent movements. They looked long-term at these movements and which ones were more likely to deliver the goals of the movements themselves, and they found that nonviolent movements were twice as effective as violent movements. And one, you might say, why is that the case? The basic answer is that it lowered the bar to participation. So when you're nonviolent, you actually open up the participation possibilities to everyone. When you're looking at taking up arms, you're usually talking about young people, usually male, who are willing to fire on each other and be killed. When you talk about nonviolent movements, there's a whole spectrum of creativity accessible. It makes it easy for young and old and black and white, people all across the spectrum who can join. And it also reduces the potential of repression. And when the repression happens, or if it happens, the general public usually sides with the nonviolent protesters. When you have violent protesters, people think, oh, they had it coming. They got what they deserved. And we find that repression on nonviolent movements actually backfires on the regime and encourages people to support and join the nonviolent movements. And in general, nonviolent movements are not only twice as successful as these violent movements, but they're also 11 times larger. And as we talked about it, people power is another name for civil resistance or nonviolent action. It's all about building up people and numbers and in power that we can leverage. This is an example of using humor, beating a barrel in, that has Slobodan Milosevic's face on it from the Otpar movement in Serbia. And we'll take one more look at the women's movement for peace in Liberia. And one of the cardinal lessons about nonviolent movements is that you have to use whatever you have accessible to you. And it is then encouraging of everybody to participate. And so in Liberia, they not only marched, they used their cultural things, but they also called for a sex strike because they really wanted to impact the women who were waging civil war in their country. So we're going to take now take the information from the bigger scale, the bigger picture of movements, and look a little bit more at the strategies, principles, theories, and tactics that go into making these movements effective. We talked about how one of the keys to effective nonviolent campaigns is innovation of tactics. And actually, there are three big things that we identify as making nonviolent movements really successful. One is adherence to nonviolence in our movement, as we were talking about. The second one is unity or solidarity, standing together, which helps us build our numbers. And the third one is actually planning. The capacity to plan allows us to escalate our tactics. It allows us not to just march over and over again and expect results when we don't get results from just marching. And so it becomes really, really critical. And the book Beautiful Trouble was written by about 70 artists and activists so that we could learn from the work that we did all over the globe. And we could teach each other as activists what to expect. A critical thing to know about is that when you think about the work we do, most people like to talk about tactics because they're the sexy, cool thing. And we're gonna talk a bunch about tactics. But if you don't have a strategy that your tactics fit into, your tactics are unlikely to deliver what you want. And you'll notice, right? You can see it's only one level of the work that you're gonna do when you're building an effective campaign. So if we take a step and look at an action theory would be something like action logic. Can people tell what's happening in this picture? People recognize Bree Newsom, who took down the Confederate flag. And she did this, and this picture tells a young African-American woman is taking down the Confederate flag. And so when you have an action, when you're planning something to do, you're gonna wanna think about, does the picture of the action tell the story, right? So that's one really basic theory. There's a great principle that we talk about, making the invisible visible. Sometimes the first job of an activist is actually to make the problem visible. And you could clearly understand it from an environmental perspective. This is from a still from the movie Gasland, where we have lit the water coming out of the faucet, it's actually the air before the water, coming out of the faucet on fire due to fracking, making the poisoning actually visible. You could also make the invisible visible by talking about things that are hidden culturally or ideologically. And this is a really beautiful example of a creative action where they made a coffin covered in mirrors and walked in Ferguson to reflect back the systemic problems that were being faced and to lift up the murder of black men and women in the communities around the United States. So this made the invisible visible too. This is a really beautiful story about using cultural assets. These are Burmese monks who traditionally take alms to survive, and instead of taking alms from the military dictatorship, they would turn their bowls upside down and not take them. And this was not just a nice thing to do, right? This was an affront to people's ability actually to get to the next life, to be able to enjoy themselves in heaven. So without being able to give alms, you were not allowed to do that. So this is a really, really powerful statement to use any cultural tools that you have. This is a beautiful example from Turkey. This is Istanbul, and it is a public iftar meal after Ramadan, using both the power of ritual, the same as you would use the example from South Africa and the funeral processions, and also it put people in a dilemma situation where the police did not want to disrupt this powerful dinner scene, this religious scene in the streets. And this was after the government had banned mass public events. So it was a really incredible cultural event. One of the things we talked about was constructive work. Another name for it is prefigurative intervention. These two examples, one is from a protest around the Dakota Access Pipeline, and they embodied the call for alternative energy and stopping the pipeline by building a solar barn right on the predicted path of the pipeline. And the other one is a picture about a daycare center, there was a group organizing for daycares, centers in where they worked in Rhode Island, and they were being ignored. And so one day their direct action was actually to go into the daycare center, go into the building where they were working, and organize a daycare center in the boss's office. So they brought their babies and their diapers and their toys, and they set up for the day, which proved to them what they needed, and eventually they won. A beautiful example that happened in Germany, talking about a decision dilemma. There were neo-fascists marching in Germany, and another group pledged that for every kilometer that they marched, they would donate money to an organization working against the neo-fascists. And so they didn't know what to do. Like, they widely publicized it. If they marched, all this money would go to a group that was against them, and if they didn't march, they failed. So some of them did march, but not for that far. It's a beautiful thing. And I throw this one in here because it's one of my favorite things. Identity correction. This is a picture of the Yes Men pretending to be Bhopal executives taking responsibility for poisoning thousands of Indians when one of their plants, their chemical plants, blew up. They still have not done this. The Union Carbide has still not taken responsibility for this instance, and so they had to come out and say, no, we're not doing that, that's not us. But actually putting out what should be happening is a very powerful thing to do. You have to build your own website and all that stuff, but you can all do that. So a couple more pictures, just to give people ways to think about it. So Martin Luther King actually said that the future depends on those who are creatively maladjusted. So we like to talk about that and creative disruption. One of the slides is a banner drop and a singing action that happened in St. Louis, bringing the issues of the murders of black men into the white halls, as it were, of show of the Requiem. And the other one is LGBTQ activists glitter bombing Rick Santorum. And so one of the great things about glitter is that it gets everywhere and it sticks on you and it doesn't go away and it looks lovely. And so he had glitter on him the whole time he was doing his talk. So creative disruptions without resorting to violence. I'll just put out media jacking. If you can go where the media is already, then you also get your media work done for you. So one example is John Carlos on the stand of the Olympics in 1968, I believe it was. The other one is a statement, Code Pink action in the halls of Congress, showing that Condoleezza Rice had blood on her hands. And another one is fighting Petraeus's nomination, I believe. And I think this might be the last one, guerrilla projection. When we want to say something and we don't want to leave a mark and we want to make it big, you can project images. And one is from Washington, D.C. just a couple weeks ago when we projected on the Department of Justice. And the other one is the Cliffs of Dover welcoming refugees. And there are all kinds of ways to make your statement. This is the human banner not too far from here, California. And it obviously says resist. We offer that there's many ways to make statements, whether they're banner drops off of balconies, whether they're people organized, whether they're, if you don't have anywhere to hang your banner, you can use helium balloons, but there's lots of ways to actually figure out how to make your statement. Oh yes, so we'll just leave it at that. So that's our sort of slideshow about nonviolent action. Do you want to add any thoughts about that to get us going?
I think this last one is quite creative, and I think that it shows what a handful of people or even a single person can do to put up a word or a slogan that represents change and protest.
Excellent. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to invite people onto stage to help us role play a couple of things. So if you have, I think it was a green card, why don't you make your way up to the steps over here, and we'll be starting our role plays in just a minute. Great. Excellent. So come on up. Don't be shy. That can stay there. Oh yeah, I'm going to need your microphone, I guess. No, yeah, that's good. You can leave it right here. Sure, woohoo! No, I'm gonna use it, actually. It's good. Great, so I'm gonna invite you all to come up here, and If you wouldn't mind, we're going to have two rows of people, shoulder to shoulder. One row will be facing the audience. One row will be facing the person over here, right here on this white line here. Everybody on the same line. Come on up. You guys look beautiful. So some people should be shoulder to shoulder on this line too, and then we'll open it up a little bit. But just so you everybody's going to find a partner. So it should be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Can you turn, come around here? Can I have another line of people right here facing people? Shake hands across. You're going to shake hands across and find a partner. Come on over here. Over here. Come on, fill in. There you go. Find a partner across. There you go. Everybody got one? Can you pivot around a little bit? There you go. Yep, come over. Who doesn't have a partner? There we go. So I want to just say thanks to everybody for coming up here. We are doing a bit of an experiment because there's such a large group. So now, this is where I'm going to set up this role play. So we call these things hassle lines. This will be in a chance to explore conflict, conflict exploration, conflict de-escalation. And yeah, we'll be filming you. We're going to open this line up a little bit. Do they need another round of applause? Come on, give them some love. That's great. So I just want you to know if you had this been a specific training for a particular action or a smaller group, everyone would be doing this role play with us. So we're just doing it. This is a real experiment to see how much people can take away from what we call modeling or fishbowling our exercises. So we're really happy that you're all up here with us. And so this will be a mini role play. You're going to interact just with the person across from you. Right, and actually, in a minute when we start, I'll have you kind of pivot so that you're on angles with each other, maybe something like that. But what I'll do is give you a scenario. I'm going to assign a role to this whole line. I'll give a role to this whole line. I'll say go. You'll get like a minute or two to act it out. You can be yourself. You can be somebody else, but just be consistent with whoever you're playing. And it's a really great opportunity to then. Debrief what happens and talk about what we want. So like almost anything in life, the more you put into it,
the more you get out.
Oh, let's try that again. The more you put into it,
the more you get out.
Excellent. Great. So I'm going to offer you that. So let's see. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to be outside walking around LA somewhere. I don't know where we are, a park, a street, whatever it is. And for some reason, I don't know exactly why, but this line of people who's facing the audience, you're kicking a dog. I mean, you're going to town on the dog. Maybe the dog bit you. Maybe it bit somebody else. Maybe you stepped in poop. Maybe it's your dog. Maybe it's somebody else's dog. I have no idea, but you're kicking the dog. You're going to town. Now, I don't know exactly why, but all of you with the back to the audience so far, you want that person to stop kicking the dog. Maybe it's your dog. Maybe you just like dogs. Maybe you just think it's unfair. I have no idea. But just you really want that person to stop kicking the dog. Has everybody got that? Okay, so what I'm going to ask you to do, though, because we're going to try this, can you just sort of step this way so you're angled, so your partner is sort of at an angle so people are opened up a little? You're good. You can face straight. Yeah, there you go. Just angle a little bit. Is this good? Or maybe we do it from here, too. Yeah, you're good that way. Here, why don't you step this way just a tiny bit? But you're still going to interact with the person over there, okay, so people can see more. All right. Are you ready? Remember, you're going to interact. And when I say freeze, you're going to stop moving. I'll get the audience to yell with me. And just look where you are, and then we'll debrief it, okay? All right. Everybody ready? One side's going to kick the dog. The other side wants to get them to stop kicking the dog. Everybody ready? Here we go. Kick that dog. Go, go. Kick that dog. Great. Here you can.
I got to kick this dog.
You can come over here.
Put your body in front of the dog.
Go ahead. Okay. Okay, we'll take one more minute. Okay, freeze. Freeze. You can yell freeze with me. Freeze. Great. So take a deep breath in and shake it out. Let it go. step away from your person. You can step away from your dog kicker person. That's great. And if we want, we can sort of turn around so the audience can see us a little bit more. But that might be easier. We'll just sort of clump up. Oh, you get a round of applause. That's awesome. Great. So I have a mic and Chelsea has a mic. We're going to take a few comments. So first of all, I'd like to hear from maybe a dog kicker. How did that feel? Anybody? How did it feel?
Horrible.
Horrible. Anybody else? How did it feel?
I'm an animal lover.
That's right. So one of the things that's a benefit about these role plays, and I encourage you to use them, is that it allows you to get in somebody else's shoes, right? You may never kick a dog in your life. However, you might want to know how somebody feels who kicks a dog. Or maybe not. But, you know, that's the idea. So it will give you that chance. What about people who tried to stop them from kicking a dog? How did that feel?
A little frustrating.
Anybody else?
I love my dog, and I love animals in general way too much that it would hurt me that someone would ever want to hurt a small little innocent dog.
Okay.
So I would like put my life in front of another animal and or human.
Right, and in fact, I saw that you did that, right? So if we look at what people did up here, we had modeling of a lot of ways of de-escalation. So the first thing that I'm going to say is that when I said go, the volume went up, the movement got fast, and people stepped right in there, right? What did you actually do? What's your name?
I actually physically jumped in front of the animal and let her kick me.
Right. So that's one of the things, right? It incorporates direct intervention. No! So there is a problem with that, right? What's the problem with that? You could also get hurt, right? I've seen also another way to directly intervene in this case is to take the dog or whatever it is and run away with it. Like, remove the problem. That's another option, right? What else did people try? Wait, say that?
I called the police.
So what do we think about this? Is that an escalative or de-escalative action? That could be escalative. So, and in fact, once you call the police, you're no longer in control. Just be really clear, and be really clear that there are populations, particularly folks of color, particularly undocumented folks, lots of people who've had experience that isn't so pleasant with police, that it wouldn't be helpful to call the police. So just to put that out there. Also, let's talk a little bit more about, let's have from the people who were kicking the dog. Did your partner do anything that caused you to stop kicking the dog besides lying down? Dog kickers?
Yeah, when her body was in my way, I didn't want to kick her as much as I wanted to kick the dog, so I had to get creative.
Had to get creative, right? How about, what did people try? Oh, yeah, go.
I had to come up with a rationale for what I was doing. So I was thinking of, you know, pit bulls and you know, acting as if pit bulls needed to be, like, erased off the face of the earth because they're bad. You know, that's what I had to think about it.
You had to think about it. In fact, so who was your partner? And what did you do?
I just got in her way. You know, I think you mentioned that, but I couldn't think of any other way to make her stop. I said, just kick me. Because I knew she wouldn't kick me.
Uh-huh.
So that was the only thing I could think of to slow her down.
Okay, so the first thing that should happen when you're faced with something, an event, a crisis, is that, you know, you want to have, like, red flashing lights go off. You want to assess the situation. I've been trying out this little mnemonic, A, B, C, D, E. So A would be for assess. You're like, oh, my gosh, somebody's kicking the dog. And the next thing would be, what should I do about it, right? Breathe. How do people center? What do people do to get calm and centered? Anybody? Yeah.
Life. I mean, I meditate, but I don't think I'd take a minute to, like...
Meditate? Okay, meditating. What else? What do people do?
I breathe.
You breathe?
I breathe.
Yeah.
I try to observe the room and just find some solid objects that can keep me in reality.
Great. Because one of the things about being an activist on the street is that, do you make good decisions when you're panicked or when you're agitated? Not generally. So we encourage people to think about how you yourself can center to get to a place where you make good decisions. I mean, remember that old 1 count to 10 thing? That could work. Breathing. If you're a meditator, think about where you are. It's pretty easy to be centered on a nice little pillow in a beautiful place. So think about doing it when you're walking down the street. Think about what that means or when the police are around. And then this, so it's A for assess, breathe for B for breathe and center, and C would be choose. It's all about choice. Are you going to escalate or de-escalate? And what does that mean? Oh, I'm using the wrong mic, aren't I? So it's really important that you realize that you have a choice. And I think Jim Lawson was talking about the fact that you need to choose what you're going to do. And when we talk about escalating or de-escalating, if you are putting your body in the in between, is that escalative or de-escalative? It could be both, right? So but people here, did anybody introduce themselves to the person they were with? Hey, my name's Nadine. How are you doing? Did anybody? Did anybody try to talk to somebody just generally? What did you do?
I tried to offer him help for whatever the issue that he was having with the dog was.
And how did that go?
Not as well as I would have liked.
Did you stop?
Well, the problem, I assumed the role of I adopted dog owner privilege, so I could do whatever I want. And like I was not seeing any kind of reason to temper my own privileged life.
Mm. So did anything happen? Did anybody else get presented with something that stopped them besides being intervened in any way? Yeah. Or what did you try?
I tried to suggest maybe the dog belongs to somebody else to start yelling out if just like whose dog is this?
Great. Kind of stuff. And did that work?
Kind of. I made my own justification of the dog was biting my dog, and so there is a more urgent matter at hand to get the other dog to stop. Mm-hmm. So, but I was a rational person, so I was stopping to talk to this person.
Great. All right, well, we're going to do another little role play, and then we'll debrief that again. So, I think we're going to stay with the same partners, just because it's, I don't want to try to figure out how to change it. So, let's see. The role play that we're going to do is, I know there's a lot going on around housing in LA and in the area. So we are going to be at a city planning hearing, a planning commission hearing. And you all, with the back to the audience currently, are going to be activists who have decided to disrupt a city planning commission hearing because you've written letters, you've talked to your people, you've done everything, you're not being heard, and you've decided to go in there and shut down the hearing until they actually make a real commitment to affordable housing. You all know why you're there, right? Okay, great. So now, people facing the audience, your job, you're just at the planning commission hearing. You want to know what's going on. You don't know anything really. You maybe know a little bit about the issue, but you're not necessarily activists. You're just in the community. Maybe you're on the other side completely. It's possible. But you're really there to hear what's going on at the commission hearing. Do you understand that? You guys understand your role? And you all understand your role as your goal is to disrupt the hearing? And you all, you just want to hear. You want these guys to be quiet because you want to hear what's happening. Right? Everybody got it? All right. Take 10 seconds to think about your role, and all right, go, disrupt the hearing, disrupt the hearing, disrupt the hearing, disrupt the hearing. Oh my gosh. All right, that's great. Okay, you ready? Let's yell freeze. 1, 2, 3. Freeze! Freeze! Excellent. Nice job. Take a deep breath in. Let it out. Step away from your partner. All right, we got a round of applause out of that. So, we're going to debrief this one. So, protesters. Who wants to tell me how it felt to be a protester? How did it feel?
I enjoyed the shouting.
You enjoyed the shouting. Anybody else? How did it feel?
I did this like last month, so.
Excellent. We got a hardcore. Yeah?
I wouldn't have gone in there with an individual plan myself. It would be something that would be systematically organized to do the same thing, everybody at once. Because otherwise, it's just like, you know, we're talking to each other, and that's not getting anywhere.
Yep. Okay. Cool. So what about you all who wanted to hear? How did that feel? Anybody want to tell me? How did it feel? What was going on?
I just replicated the behavior that I've been seeing from people in my own canvassing and protesting, which is pretty, I don't know, unaware and closed-minded.
Did you manage to get him to be quiet?
No.
Did anybody try anything that worked? Yeah. What'd you do?
So my whole tactic was de-escalating and actually having a conversation saying, you know what, it's not fair that you are screaming because other people need to listen, and no one's listening if you just yell. So I think that she got a little bit quiet.
Yeah, that's great. So if we think about escalating and de-escalating, right, we assess, we breathe and center, and we choose to de-escalate. In this case, right, there are things that we can do. What are your options if somebody's screaming at you? Option is?
Listen.
Listen, right? That's a really good thing. How do people know if you're listening? They lean in, they nod, they might ask you a question, right? Who here is a good listener? Oh, come on. Okay. We all can be better listeners, though, but listening is the first line of defense. What else? Somebody's screaming at you. Ah! What can you do? Yeah.
Just stand there and take it and just see their... You feed off their emotion, because if somebody's screaming at you, they have a lot of emotion, pent-up anger, and you just stand there and take it and take off their last emotion.
Great. Mm-hmm.
You could use humor. I heard about a protest where some pro-Trump protesters showed up, and they were starting to sort of shout back at the protesters, and the anti-Trump protesters started hollering, I guess, and they were hollering, "Bless your heart."
That's great. So how is humor escalative or de-escalative? What do you think? Oh, it depends, right? So be ready if you use humor, or, you know, if you say something like, "What about them, Mets or something?" Then watch out. But anyways, so this could be really great. Your content really matters. The other thing, if with somebody's yelling at you, you can wait them out, right? You can put distance between yourself and them. You can also start yelling at the same level that they're yelling, and then bring your voice quieter and slower, right? Because is speed escalative or de-escalative? It's escalative, right? Especially we really encourage people not to run, and particularly don't, if you're a person of color, don't run away from the police, right? That'll get you shot. So we really want people to think about what's escalative and de-escalative, and if you're interested in staying in a place a longer time, it's usually better to de-escalate. So that's the D, A, B, C, D. If you're trying to do something like that, then you want to de-escalate. Thinking about establishing a relationship, asking people questions, that's a really powerful thing. What about body language? What do you do with your body if you want to de-escalate? Anybody? What do you do with your hands? Keep it neutral, right? Your hands might be open. It's not, you know, take me to your leader. It's here I am, I don't have anything in my hands. Is that normal for an activist not to have anything in their hands? No. So if you usually have a pole or something that could be construed as a weapon, what you want to do is put it down. How do you put it down? Do you throw it down fast? You want to put it down slowly. And in fact, you want to say to the person, I'm going to put my sign down now, and you do it nice and slowly. So those are just some things to think about for de-escalation. All right, how about another round of applause for these folks? I'd like to, can you put the slide on for just a minute? And as we're gonna do another quick little role play before we take a break. So if you could get into three groups of people, three circles of people maybe sitting on the floor, one group here. If you want a chair, there's a couple chairs. Another group here, can you get in a circle of about six or folks in the group? And can you sit there? Yep, that would be great. Awesome. So one of the things that we're talking about, I mean, we talked a little bit about de-escalation and trying to be more effective at meeting our goals. One of the ways you can be more effective as well is by working in groups, right? Working in small groups. Why would we encourage people to work in groups? So take a minute and have a conversation, just like 1 minute in your little circle, about why would you work in a small group, all right? And if you're in the audience, please feel free to talk to the person next to you. What's the benefit about working in small groups? Why would we do it? Take a minute to think about that.
Okay, great. We're going to harvest some of the thinking from the folks on the stage and talk a little bit about why we would work in small groups. So who from this group? All right, we'll try this. This is a really useful tool. If you're ever on a street protest and you have thousands of people, if people know this tool about being quiet, once folks are quiet, you can then communicate with people. And that's really helpful. So from this group, who wants to share one reason why you might work in a group?
There's cooperation.
There what?
I was just making, there's a passing of the buck in a small group. It's easier to build consensus among a smaller number of people, but then you also have more than just yourself acting toward a common goal.
Great.
And it's easier to schedule meetings with fewer people.
This is absolutely true. How about this group? Who wants to share something?
It seems like there's something that happens in a small group where ideas just come from nowhere. You know, like ideas that are much better than individually we could come up with.
Great. And how about something from that group? Who wants to share? Why would you work in a small group?
More of an opportunity to air ideas. People with the best ideas usually are more self-aware, may have doubts about the validity of them and won't bring them up in large crowds.
Great. So one of the things that we find is that when we're preparing for doing any kind of action, it would really help to work in small groups. I work with little kids, I work with old folks. You can ask little kids, why would you work with other people? And they'll say, because it's more fun. Or you'll have someone to sit with at lunch. So let's just be really clear that we can do a lot better work if we build our groups up and build our support group, our networks up. That's one of the cardinal things that will inspire people to take action, is feeling like there's other people there with them. Now, if we're a group, one of the words that we use is affinity groups, which is a group, which is a name that comes from folks who fought the Spanish Civil War against fascism. Grupos de Afinidad is the way it came over from Spain. It was widely used in the anti-nuclear movements here, and if people don't know, you know, nuclear power industry was basically stopped by ordinary people fighting the nuclear power industry. There hasn't been a power plant built in the U.S. since the late 70s, and it's just because of people who stood up and resisted in small groups like affinity groups. It helps make quick decisions, right, because you get to know each other, and it reduces infiltration as well. And it helps you get more work done, and it helps you get better ideas. So all those things are true. I like to think about it, too, is that, you know, of any given 10 people at any given moment, at least somebody's paying attention, right? And so that's really helpful. So we're going to do a really quick little exercise now. I'm going to give you a decision to make, and then we're going to talk a little bit about roles, about what you might want in your affinity group. So here's the situation. We're going to start on this. You're three affinity groups, and you've decided to do a blockade of, of a city council meeting, because it's a meeting where they've decided to put in an oil rig or a fracking rig in your neighborhood, and you just want to shut that meeting down. You're done. You've already done all the work. You know, they haven't listened to you. You're going to shut it down. And you went early to shut down the city that day. You were there from like 6 a.m. to about, it's now about 9 a.m. or 10 a.m., 3 hours later. You've had a really successful blockade. You're at three different doors. You had lots of media coming and going. Now the media is already gone. You got good legal advice before you sat down that your blockade would just be a small charge, maybe a misdemeanor at most, but probably just an infraction, a little ticket. You'd pay out and you'd be done. However, the police have just come up to you at your little blockades and said, if you want to get up and leave now, we'll give you 2 minutes to decide. You can just go. We won't charge you with anything. But if you stay here, we're going to throw the book at you. We're going to charge you with a felony, could be $10,000, 10 years in jail. You have 2 minutes to decide what to do. Everybody understand the problem? Okay, here's another direction. They're little cards. And you can take one or not, pass them around. They're little spikes. If you can incorporate what it says on the card into your role, that will help the conversation happen. All right, is everybody ready? All right, so the police have said, go ahead, you have 2 minutes to make your decision, go. If you don't get up, we're gonna arrest you. So go for it, have a conversation about what you're gonna do. So you could talk too if you wanted about what you would do if you were in the same situation where the police gave you 2 minutes to stay or go. You wanted to shut down the city council? What? You know, maybe you should go. I don't know. They're out. Okay, you ready? Those of you in the audience, on the count of three, you're under arrest. One, two, three. You're under arrest! All of you who didn't go anywhere, you're under arrest. All right. There we go. Except, looks like, I don't know, some of them made a decision. So we're going to take this moment to actually do a little debrief of both what their decision-making process, if they had one, and to find out what kind of problems they had in their groups. So let's find out. So maybe from the FAR group, did you all make a decision? Did you make a decision in your group about what to do?
Yes.
They did. What were you going to do? Stay.
We're all staying.
And did you see how they locked their arms and they were holding space? Pretty good, right? What about in the middle group? Did you stay, go? What were you going to do?
We were all pretty much agreed to leave, and I started getting worried that the 2 minutes was, you know, about up.
You were worried that 2 minutes was about up. Okay, they were going to go. All right. And what about you all? What did you decide to do?
We were going to call our lawyer, but I'm on. There was a consensus because I was undocumented that I should go regardless of what.
Wait. Go ahead. Use the mic.
For example, we have somebody with immigration issues. We kind of agreed very quickly that was probably not a good plan to have somebody with immigration issues given the current climate. The other ones we were kind of going back and forth a little bit.
Great. So can I buy a show of hands of the three groups here? How many of you had some kind of process for making your decision? Did anybody have a process? Yeah? What kind of process did you have?
Well, just considering what the risks are versus what the likelihood was that what they were saying, what the police was saying was correct.
Ah, okay. So, do police lie? Okay, and can they just charge you with a felony like that? No, why not? Because police don't charge you, right? So is it totally normal that the police could say they were gonna charge you with a felony? Yes. So how would you find out? Anybody, what would you do?
Well, couldn't they make something up? Couldn't they create a scenario?
Oh, the police could create a scenario, but that's not really what we're talking about. I mean, in this situation, they can do whatever they want, it is true. However, one of the things to know is that you all had, or some of you had cell phones probably on your body, right? Did you call your lawyer? They were calling their lawyer, yes! All right, so they had legal. And when we talk about when you prepare for a role in the street, one of the things you probably should do is get legal advice. One of the groups that offers free legal advice is called the National Lawyers Guild, and I would really support working with them. The ACLU, I know locally, is also very active, so you can get advice from them as well. But getting good legal advice, and if you have a phone with you, and should you have your phone with you? Well, if you don't want to have your personal phone, you should get a burner phone, right? So you should have some way to be in touch with the media. You should have some way to be in touch with lawyer if you need to, that kind of stuff, right? Okay, so one of the things you could do in your group is have some kind of process for making a decision. You could do a quick go-round. Everybody can say one word, stay or go, right? That would have been easy. The other thing, you might need a facilitator for that, right? Did anybody take leadership in the group saying, hey, I'll facilitate quickly? Did anybody do that? You guys don't know each other really well, but if you were a group that worked together over time, maybe you would have done that. The other thing is that there were three doors. You all were at three doors, but you didn't talk to each other, and I didn't say you couldn't. Yeah. Oh, you did? You did? Oh, I missed. No, okay. But sometimes you could have a runner, right? That's a job where you could send somebody to talk to the other people, or you could call them on your phone, or maybe they've got the text loop happening and you all know what's going on anyways. So different ways of communication are really important. Another really quick way to make decisions is by using hand signals, right? Whether it's thumbs up, thumbs down, you want to stay, you want to go, you don't care, hands in the middle, or even using twinkle fingers, a sign language for applause if you agree with something that somebody says. But there are ways of making pretty quick decisions in a group, having a facilitator or having other tools that can help people get heard and make a decision. So in the groups, yeah, there were immigration problems, so you definitely want to think about it if you are risking arrest versus what your goal was. If your goal was to shut down the place early and to get good media attention and you already had that accomplished, then maybe you do want to get up and not pay money into the system or spend all your time caught up in a legal system and rather get back to work, right? All the activist work that we need to do. There were other issues in the groups. What else was in your group that you had to deal with? Anybody? What did you have?
I was underage.
You were underage. Mm-hmm. So one of the things is that if you're underage, sometimes you're separated out from the groups that you came with, so you should know that. You have to check with your legal circumstances, your legal authorities. And also you might need somebody who actually has parental responsibilities to get the kid out. And so you should know that ahead of time if that's the case, right? What else do we got here?
I had a paternity suit and children to worry about, so.
Right, so there are some people who really don't want to risk a felony charge, and even if I say that the police can lie and they're not the ones that throw a felony charge at you, there could be a chance that the police would somehow prevail on the prosecutor to throw really big charges at you for any reason. So it's just, you really want to get good legal advice, you want to learn to work with each other. I know there was medical problems in some of these groups too, so presumably if you're working together over time, which is not always the case. Sometimes you meet up your affinity group right on site. You want to know who's got medication needs, who's got limitations on their time if possible, documentation status, and all these other things that could go into deciding as a group what to do. It's also possible that you don't have to all do the same thing, right? You could have sent three people out. Is that something that you thought about?
No, I mean, I think we all had circumstances that prevented us from wanting to stay, but I think the other groups had that option.
Great.
We did start to have that conversation.
Wait, you can't hear it.
We did start to have that conversation, though, but we ran out of time.
So what about time? Is it, like, typical that you might have 2 minutes to make that decision? Is that real? Yeah, it's totally real, actually. You could have less time. You could have planned ahead of time. We hope that you planned ahead of time for different possibilities, but it may not happen. But it is totally possible. I've even seen cops say, you have 2 minutes or 10 minutes, and they come back early, and we say, hey, it's only been a minute. You promised us 2 minutes. And I've seen them go, okay, and they give me another minute. Can't guarantee it, but did anybody in these groups keep time? Oh, they did over here. Awesome. So that's something to think about, keeping time to make sure that everybody in your group gets heard and using the time that's allotted well. So I hope that was useful. Let's give them a round of applause talking about affinity groups.
Thank you.
Great. I don't know if there's one more. So you can all return back to your seats. Just as they return to their seats, I'll just call your attention up here to a slideshow. Oops, it's not up. Maybe you can have the slides up if possible. Really quickly while you return to your seats. And after we review this, we're going to take a quick break. But you can see that there are different roles that you might want in your affinity group. And there are different ways to help with quick decision making. And we're really glad. You don't need all of these roles in your affinity groups all the time, but you may want to think about what roles you would need in the particular actions that you're taking. All right, so thank you all for this. I think we're going to take a 12-minute break. Some of you fabulous people volunteered to be part of our next role play. And if you could make your way back to the stage, right up to the stage right now, that would be really great. I think you have an orange card or a pink card, whatever it is, you got a card. If you could come on over right now, that would be great. We're going to prepare for the next role play. This one is going to be what we call a full-blown mass action role play. We're going to model, and please keep on coming up. There should be about 20 of you, 25 of you. We're going to split the role play into police and protesters. We're going to have the protesters prepare to march. We're going to have the police stop them in one form or another. This may escalate beyond what you normally would expect to happen here in LA. I know that the police here are used to nonviolent protesters in some ways, but we'll see what happens with the role play. So we've got, let's see, how about those of you with odd numbers? Can you come over here and suit up as police? If you're okay with that, odd number. If not, any even number folks could come over here. You're gonna be the protesters and you're gonna talk to each other and organize amongst yourselves. I think we have maybe a few more people coming up. If you really want to be a police, you can be a police anyways. It's fine, either one. Protester, how many folks we got? If we have any other people who want to play with us in this role play, feel free to come up. So, we need a few more cops. Can you both be police? There we go, join the police. There we go, we got a few more people coming up. Excellent. A few more protesters, a few more cops. There we go. Oh, we don't. Now we need some more protesters, too. There we go. So here's the situation. As you are preparing, protesters, I'm going to give you a little some directions for the protest crew and some directions for the police. Can you all pay attention for while you're suiting up just for a moment? Here we go. We're going to give you guys a couple minutes to talk, but this is the scenario. We know that the Pride March is coming up, right? And we know that this year Pride is talking about making it more of a protest rather than a celebration, giving the national context. And it sounds like a great thing to me. So the Pride March here is actually, you're meeting in a park, getting ready to march. There are, you can't see it from the audience probably, but there are white lines here. This is the pathway that you're gonna march in because this is not real life, but in real life you would have a street or some other way of delineating where you're marching, but this is what we're gonna do in this small scale role play. So you're going to talk to each other, decide how you're going to march. I don't know, maybe you're going to have roles. Maybe there's some things going on. But your job, right, is to go to City Hall. City Hall is obviously over there being protected by our city's finest, the police. And like any role plays, right, if you can be more serious in your role, if these people can try to play police as if they think police will act, that will be helpful. And you all are protesters. You can play protesters as if you were going to do it. Your job is to march from the park you're meeting in. I'll give you a minute to talk to each other. We'll talk to the police. And you're going to march down this pathway to try and present a petition or hold or, you know, maintain your position at the City Hall for some amount of time, right, to get your message out. That's correct. Trying to get from point A to point B. So go ahead and talk to each other, decide how you're going to march, if you've got any roles or things organized. Police also, right, you're a hierarchical institution. You got to talk to each other. Who's in charge? Is there an officer? Who's the lieutenant? Or who's the highest in charge? Figure it out. Okay, great. So I'm going to talk to you just for a minute, and I'm putting this. So I want you guys to hold your poles, be really, with two hands. I can't hold it. I'm holding this. You're going to push them back, 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 right? The person who's in charge will be behind them, right? And you want to line up. Try to force them to sit. At one point, if it doesn't escalate, you can beat somebody and drag them away. Somebody should decide on who can drag somebody away, right? Okay? And it can all happen sort of at once. We're going to do it really quickly.
No.
You don't have to. You don't have to have the hat on. Okay, you ready? You guys shouldn't. But anyways, line up and get ready. Okay, so we're going to have the police get ready, and the folks can march whenever they want. You guys are starting to march. Come on. Let's do it. Get ready. You guys want to line up? You don't have to go too much further than this. And you want to hold it. Okay, you guys, let's march. Let's see what happens in our protest. Are you ready to march? Here we go. You ready? Ready. Go for it. Okay, so let's watch what happens, and then when I call, we'll call freeze together, and we'll debrief what happens in this role play. Go ahead. Do it. Okay, police, you can advance on them. Police, go ahead and advance. 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 Hold them back. Advance on them. Push them back. Push them back. 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 You can arrest them. You can beat them. You can beat them. Go arrest somebody or beat somebody. Go arrest somebody. You guys, sit down, sit down, you guys. Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down. Sit down. Woo! No, you're good. Okay, so what's happening? It's quiet. Put your hands up. Who's in charge? To make an order to arrest or something?
We need to move in and arrest these folks. You are all under arrest for civil disobedience. Please, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to give you 30 seconds to get up and remove yourselves from this situation. Otherwise, we will arrest you.
Beat somebody on the head.
All right, let's go in.
Go help her.
Pull them out. Pull them out.
Okay. Help her out. Help her out. Stop laughing and help her out. Okay, let's yell free. Let's yell freeze. One, two, three. Freeze! Cut! Excellent. Can we have a round of applause for this little mini role play? You guys can stay there for just a second. Well, you can do whatever you want. Okay, so let's hear, actually. I want to hear a little bit about what they think happened. So, protesters, did you have a plan?
Yes.
Okay, so who can tell me the plan? Can you tell me the plan?
We were going to put the women in front, we were going to lock arms, and we were going to keep walking no matter what.
Wow, all right. And how did that work out? Cops, how did that work out with you? Who's a cop person? What was your job? Here, can you fill in over here? Let's come upstage a bit so we can talk. Come on, cops, come in over here. So how did it work out? What happened? Was there a plan for the cops?
Yeah, they won.
Tell us.
I'm not good at playing a cop, so I was a...
Well, it is true. I did mention it is helpful, like other role plays, to be able to get into somebody else's shoes. So if you're someone who thinks you can't ever be a cop, you should actually role play a cop for sure at your next training, just to see what's happening, right? So the cop's idea was that they were going to hold the line. But the advancing mob actually bullied over these cops who weren't very determined to hold the line. Now, what do you all think about that? What is it? Is it escalating? Is it de-escalating? Is it okay to push against the cops in this way? What do you think? What do you think?
It was probably escalating, but we had got to the point, sort of like what you said, tired and fed up, fired up. And so we were determined. So we were so determined, and we were locked arms that if they pulled one of us, they were going to have to pull all of us. And it almost was like the police were like, you know what? We just might let them just go. Because we were holding on, but we were determined. You don't always get an audience like that where everybody's determined, but we're doing role playing right now, so we all were determined and locked up. But, you know. So.
That's excellent. Well, one of the things I will say, and we didn't actually get to talk about this when we did our hassle line exercises, but when people are angry, do you want to touch them or not? You don't want to touch them. And what about police, especially angry police? Do you want to touch them? No, actually, there's like no rules in this work except, and what we really encourage people to do is make sure that you talk to the communities that you work with to figure out how you're going to work together. I can't tell you what to do for your circumstance. However, there's one rule that I would recommend is like don't touch a cop, don't touch a cop's car, don't touch a cop's horse, don't touch a cop's bike. And they're all extensions of the cop. And in a lot of places, particularly big cities, like where I come from in Washington, D.C., they like to throw APO, assault on police officers, at people whenever they can to actually subdue protesters. So it may be that you're fine pushing in, but it may be that that will be considered assault on police officer, and I would not recommend it. In fact, I don't recommend touching angry people because it is escalative, right? It's extraordinarily escalative. And if you decide that you want to de-escalate something, touching someone can be a big problem. So just thinking about it. But what can you do? Yeah.
We decided that we were going to go from point A to point B. So my question is, let's say, for instance, because we asked them early on, said, let's make this real, you know? So my question is, if you're faced with that situation, where whoever the opposing force is opposing you, and you want to get to point B, do you stop?
What do you think your options are? Who's got options?
I mean, how could I actually wield this? But I think somebody would have got cracked in the head.
I will say, I tried to get some of the police to arrest people and haul them off, and they were like, oh, no, not me. I have never met a police officer do that. They would be like, yeah, I'm arresting people. I'm hauling them off. So they might break some heads. They might actually use pressure points. They might do other things to get you to release from each other. However, one of the things that might happen is if the police were pushing you back and they wanted to, and you wanted to keep holding your space, what could you do if you didn't? Not get tased. Well, one of the things, and I know this is the case in LA, the same as it is in DC, it's actually, if you're a nonviolent protester, it's very unusual to get pepper sprayed or tased. That's not that the cops don't use these tools generally on ordinary people, but when you're out there protesting, if you use nonviolent tactics, you have a bit of less likelihood of getting those things used on you. They look really bad, and they stimulate, like I said, repression actually encourages people to join your resistance. But one of the things that you can do, and can I touch you?
Yeah.
Can I push you? Okay, so if I'm the police officer, and what's your name?
Angel.
If I want Angel to move, and I'm the police officer, and she's standing up, I'm just like, move, Angel, move. And I push her, and she moves, right? Will you sit down when I push you? So if I want her to move, and I go, up, she's down there. And in fact, what we find is this is a really effective way to hold space, right? And it's a very powerful way, even though sometimes it doesn't feel like it. Like when you first try sitting down, you might feel vulnerable. But it also is true that the police usually are hierarchical groups that follow orders. And if their orders are to push people back, they don't necessarily always have orders to pick people up and move them. And it usually will buy you a little bit of time to figure out what to do next. And in fact, the police officers are supposed to follow OSHA regulations just like everyone else, and they have to move people with, I mean, somebody like Angel might actually be able to be moved by one person pretty safely, but others of us will take two people to move. Right? And being intentional can actually help you stay someplace longer. But this kind of dynamic where you actually have a line of people sitting down rather than being moved and losing space is really important to consider, right? Intentionality in your work. Thank you. any other things? Yeah, we'll talk a little bit more.
Well, when we started moving, we just started chanting because that's what you do. And when we started chanting, we just started chanting, no justice, no peace, because that's what you do. But is that nonviolent to say, is there a threat of violence there if we're saying, you know, no peace?
Ah, that's really cool. So in general, do you think chanting is escalative or de-escalative? It depends how you're chanting. No justice, no peace. That's kind of escalative. No justice, no peace. It's like we're determined. We understand what's happening. So there's a huge spectrum. Same with singing or talking to people in general, right? You can tell a lot about what's happening without by the tone of your voice, the content of what you're saying, or what your body language is, right? So you have to think about that. So I don't think it's in general escalating. It just depends on how you use it. And the other thing is that it can keep you coherent. When you all sat down and then you stopped saying anything, how about that? What's that? Silent. So sometimes being silent can be powerful. But in this case, it was like people were baffled. I mean, granted, it was because you didn't have any time to plan. But, excuse me, it's really important to think about how you can use song and chanting to stay together, right? And if you did want to have people sit down and be quiet, you could have an individual step up and talk to folks. And it would be a good opportunity to share things. How can you communicate?
Cell phones.
Yep, that's a really good way. How else can you communicate with a crowd of people?
Yelling really loud.
Yelling really loud. Or there's this thing that we call
human mic.
The human mic.
The human
or
mic.
The people's mic. So we're going to model that so people know what it is. It's a really great thing to use if you're not allowed to use electronic communication. So, for example, do you want to start it? We're going to repeat after her.
Protesters.
So here's the idea. You would normally say mic check. And then people who know will respond, mic check. And so maybe it's just a small circle around you to start, and then the next layer of people would repeat, and you can communicate with hundreds of people this way. So go ahead and say people's mic check.
Mic check.
Mic check.
We are here.
We are here.
To demand
to demand justice. Perfect. So people understand how that works, and then it could actually resonate out many layers. So communication can also happen by using bicyclists, people on bikes who could, if you have a mass march or a large group of people, you could also communicate using runners, although don't really run, just walk fast, because we know running is escalative. How else could you communicate with a mass of people?
Megaphone.
Oh, you could?
Megaphone.
Megaphone would work. You can also use different colored flags or certain giant puppets. So if you have a whole crowd of people and you want to take an intersection, you might send the purple flag on the south side and the green flag on the north side and the yellow flag on the east side or whatever it is. And if you have groups, like mobile tactics like this, and you want to use flags, how many flags do you need in your group? We need more than one so that you can actually have a front and an end and people can pivot like a school of fish and go quickly in one direction or the other. Okay, so that's a communication thing. Let's see. Let's talk a little bit about personal preparation. How should you prepare yourself personally for taking action? Let's find out.
First of all, the first thing I want to say is that everything you're talking about today and different things I've seen at different marches, this example, at least for me, clearly helps me to understand this is why you prepare.
Because
then you don't know really what's what, and then you're sort of trying to follow the next person, and then you don't know what, you know, so as much preparation and planning that you can do that will help, you know, whatever you're standing up for to be more effective. So what you're doing, thank you, because this is it. We do need this.
Thank you.
So we're not just out there wondering or walking 10 blocks and we're like, when do we stop, you know?
Okay, so you point out a couple things, right? Know your situation. Have a map of the area. Scout it ahead of time if you can do it. Have a scout go out that day if you can, right? What else personally are you going to do to prepare?
Make sure I'm hydrated and nourished.
Yeah, eat and drink well. How about sleeping? You should also sleep the night before. I know most of us will be up the night before until 3 a.m. painting a banner, but it doesn't really help. See if we can do it a little earlier, right? What else?
Have someone ready to pay the bail.
Have someone ready to pay the bail. If you're going to risk arrest, you might want to have someone that has money. And is that person in the protest with you? Hopefully not. What about legal support? You might have legal observers. Those are the people who are going to keep tabs on what happens. Or maybe you have a lawyer, also probably off-site, right? What other kind of support mechanisms would you want, or roles? Yeah.
There's an app for you, ACLU, on your phone that it'll, like, video things and record. And even if your phone gets smashed or you get smashed or whatever, it'll just send the footage directly to ACLU, like, you don't have to, like, upload right. it or anything. Like,
it's called Mobile Justice, yeah. And it's not in every state. But
California Mobile Justice is the one for this one.
Awesome. Did you all hear California Mobile Justice? It uploads the video as you take it, so you can use it. It was designed to report police brutality, but it's very useful in other situations. Great. So that's really great. What else? Yeah.
Get support from, like, the media, like local TV news stations, and get their side to cover us.
Great, so you might want to have other roles like a media liaison or a police liaison, those people who talk to the media or call the media ahead of time. And police liaison isn't somebody who negotiates with the cop, but it's somebody who talks to the police because they're a hierarchical group, they're looking for a leader, but we like to build leaderful organizations, so you might just be the person designated to talk to the police that day, sort of can buy you some time, right? So those things are really important. The other thing I'll just say really quick about personal preparation, besides eating and drinking well, is you want to actually dress appropriately, right? You might actually look up a weather report. You might dress in layers. If you're going to be in an intense circumstance, you're not going to wear your finest jewelry or your best evening gown, unless that's part of the theater you're doing, right? So you want to think about preparing in those ways. And the other thing that's really important is to go with a buddy or to go with a crew of people that you trust, that you can run with. If you don't have that, at least have a phone number of somebody you can call that's not on site or someplace that you can check in with later. Does that make sense? So we just have that really short amount of time. We're going to bring Jim Lawson back up to talk some more. Any other thoughts about being in this protest situation, this little role play? Mm-hmm.
As far as dressing, dress for the audience you're trying to reach. If you're trying to reach people more moderate or on the right, like maybe don't look so much like a protester or a radical leftist that can help with your message?
We do have a principle in Beautiful Trouble that's called don't dress like a protester. So that can often be quite helpful. Any learnings from being part of this little role play here?
One thing, back to the comment you were saying, asking us earlier, is one thing I've learned in doing a lot of protests is don't do anything that you don't feel comfortable with. Mm-hmm. Because I've learned that when you're protesting, there's different people with different groups. Some people have their bail money on them and they have their attorney with them. And if you don't have that, you probably do not want to do certain things to get yourself arrested. So doing what you feel comfortable with and not being afraid to, you know, when they're about to do something that could get them arrested that you don't want to do, just sort of opting out or just slowly burn off to the side and, you know,
well,
in a way. What you feel comfortable with, and like they said, be prepared to go to jail if that's what, because some people are, they're like, I'm ready to go to jail. But if you're not ready to go to jail, you need to sort of back up out the way when things like that start happening. So only do what you feel comfortable. Don't feel peer pressure that you have to, you know, go to jail or put yourself in that situation if you're not comfortable. Because I've learned a lot of people that are ready to go to jail, they came prepared. They have the attorney, the bail money, you know, they already had it. That's why they're prepared. They're
yep. Thank you. One of the things to think about is that there are many roles to fill, and a lot of the creative actions or the wide spectrum of nonviolent action that we talked about today doesn't always involve risking arrest. Risking arrest is sometimes the easiest thing to do, not the hardest thing to do. So really think about all of the roles that go into making effective actions, everything from organizing trainings and doing strategic planning and figuring out how your tactic is going to actually work. These things are all really critical pieces of making a tactic successful. So thank you for that. And also really understanding that you can build support networks around you that enable you to take the next step, to actually invest in risk. One of the things that's very clear in this moment as activists who've been involved a long time is that we need to help people understand that being an activist is not always going to be easy. I call it sunshine activism. Like, we need to prepare people to take real risk. If we're not really willing to step into risk, we're not really going to be able to change the systems of oppression that are dividing us and poisoning us and killing our planet. So we need to be able to step into this work and figure out how we can build up each other into leadership capacities and into capacities of leaderful groups so that we can take real action to affect strategic change on the systemic problems. So just willing to throw that out there. There's a push me, pull you on this. And you had another thing to say.
Yeah, I wanted to add about speaking to the police and knowing what to say and what not to say, and just knowing your law. Like, I'm not a law professional, but I know certain things, certain rights that I have in certain situations. And if I'm caught with a gram of weed, you know, I'm over 21, so legally I can have it, but you know how that is. And
so actually, let's talk about this. If you're going to a protest, there's some things that you might not want to bring with you.
Yeah.
Like weed, a gram of
weed. Like weed might be good. Don't bring weed or illegal drugs. Yeah. Even if you're going to bring medications with you, it's good to have it in a prescription bottle that's actually got maybe even a letter from your doctor if it's something that you really need. Also, don't bring things like knives or things that could be easily misconstrued as weapons, right? Let's just try not to do that. That'll make your life. Did you want to say something else?
Yeah, I wanted to add that outsider, because I was thinking of weed outsider protesting. I've been stopped by an officer before, but
yeah, let's talk about magic words.
But in protesting, like she said, that's very important, and that's all I want to add. Thank you.
Great. And one other thing I'll say: there are magic words that you should know, right? What are the magic words that you want to say to police if you're stopped? First of all, you want to say, am I free to go? What did we say? Am I free to go? And if you're free to go, or am I under arrest? And if you're not under arrest, you're free to go. And the other thing is, if you're under arrest, if they grabbed you, whatever reason, your real magic words are, I have the right to remain silent. I want to speak to a lawyer. Let's all say that together. I have the right to remain silent. I want to speak to my lawyer. Great. So we'll take maybe one or two more. I know I saw you.
Just because you're like being nonviolent doesn't mean like your words have to be nonviolent too. Like, I would love to be out there like F the police, you know, like that's how I feel, but that's escalative. Like,
that is escalative.
You're not like actually doing anything, it's still kind of violent, sort of.
Yep.
Like,
exactly. So what you say is as important as how you say it. So let's give this crew a round of applause for participating. You can leave your police outfits in the box over there. That would be really awesome. And if we could bring the slides up while they're leaving and going to their streets, to the streets, while they're going to the streets to protest. They are human, right. We're being reminded that the cops are human also, which is a really important thing. But you can see this really quick little breakdown of action, street smarts, and personal prep, things to think about as you're taking action. Great. So we're really, really thankful that you all are participating in this work with us. Great. So we're gonna, we now have a moment to hear a little bit from Jim about the work that we've done today and our reflections on what needs uplifting and things that we haven't covered yet, because as we said in the beginning, we have so much to cover. So, shall I turn it over?
I do have a couple of ideas.
Excellent.
That I want to put out here. One of them is that we need a whole series of campaigns in the United States that can help to move the country back to its experiment in being a democratic society with access for all. We need to understand that the rise of the neoconservative, the changing of Mississippi from a democratic state, I mean a state of the Democratic Party, to a state of the Republican Party, is part of the resistance to the fact that in the 20th century, we the people of the United States were making a great deal of progress towards a more open and transparent society, a less violent society, to a dismantling of ancient forms of oppression like slavery and Jim Crow law and practice and wretched discrimination against women, and away from becoming a violent society and a empire aiming at controlling the earth. We were very, very poor people at the turn of the 19th century. It was a women's movement that helped the process of waking up, so that between 1910 and 1920, the far more radicalized National Women's Party, that was a wing of the suffrage movement and a relatively small wing, pushed radically in a fashion that allowed for the 19th Amendment. It was the organization of millions and millions of working people who at the turn of the century might be have been making 5 cents an hour in a shoe factory or in a steel mill, who pushed for wages and safety. And the emergence of many of your families and our families in the 20th century was a consequence of the working people's movements that formed and put some 50 million people into democratic local unions across the country in almost every sphere of our economy. That's what produced health care for people, what produced Social Security. It's what produced, in fact, the budgeting, the ending of poverty for millions of people in the emergence of a strong middle class. It wasn't the Chamber of Commerce or the Bank of America. It was indeed essentially campaigns of economic boycotts and strikes and lockdowns and sit-downs and many, 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 many picket lines all across the nation. Now, we need that kind of protracted struggle So I want to push that issue. And the only way that struggle can be effective is through replacing our violent language, our despising of various people, with the language of respect and love and compassion and beauty and truth. We have to replace our language. You cannot use the language of enmity and expect we're going to have a society where people get along with one another and work together for the common good. So the language has to change, and as well. So we in the struggle must learn the languages of a beloved community, which is a term we used back in the 60s quite a bit, a phrase that came out of struggle in the United States, in fact, of the 20th century, or the early 20th century. And then the final thing I'd like to say is that each of us can begin with that, because each of us can do one of the major nonviolent tactics that I know about for social change. And that is that each of us can be talking to somebody who is a male chauvinist or is a racist and does not know it, or who has lost their way. And that's called face-to-face method. Each of us can use that as a nonviolent method to be engaged on one-on-one with another person who you think is in fact irresponsible in various ways. We do have to expose the fact that even the slogan, "Make America Great Again," is a racist, chauvinist, violent slogan. It is not a slogan for the present age, whether the people who use it know it or not. And most of them do not know it. Because just as people have become invisible in the structures of crude dishonoring of people, so a person can become invisible to themselves because they've been steeped in the things that destroy their soul. So I suggest the face-to-face tactic is something that each of us can be constantly using.
That's great. Yeah.
The other thing I would add to that is this, that the fact of the matter is that violence has already reached many of its limits in the USA society and culture and in the world. The violence has nowhere to go in Iraq against ISIS, in Libya, in Serbia, in Syria, in the Sudan, in the Congo. The violence has nowhere to go in South Chicago or in the abuse in many of our homes, too many of our homes. So a part of the push for nonviolence, in my mind, is the insistence that Western civilization, the major cause of the world in which we live today, the major resource for the kind of world in which we live today and the kind of America in which we live, has no place to go and must be replaced with what Gandhi called soul force, or love force, or truth force, or the force of the spirit, the power of the character, of human character, or nonviolence. Those are all terms that I think Gandhi used for the term. So, in fact, if civilization is to have a future, then many millions and billions of us must decide that when we use love as the energy of living daily with friends and family, with extended family, that that sort of inclusive loving that is graceful and forgiving and respectful is really the power of life itself. And it's really the power, and the only power, get to create a different kind of world. So part of that, a different kind of a USA. So part of what I'm saying is that we have to become citizens of a country and a world that is, does not yet exist. We have to become people of a vision and a strength and of the power of life that can transform ourselves, our families, our friends, our neighbors, and that can transform our social action. In the final analysis, I'm talking about what essentially is a philosophy of life and limb and a philosophy of healing and a philosophy of helping ourselves and others to a different place in life.
Thank you. So we're gonna do an exercise together in just a minute where you are in your seats. But to sort of tie up some of the pieces, we looked at a very, very superficial overview of some of the movements of nonviolent that have committed to nonviolent action. It took nonviolent action to win rights and freedoms and justice in different parts of the world. We looked a little bit about how it translates into the actual specific tactics that might be taken, sort of a la Beautiful Trouble. And we looked at what it might even come down to another level. What does it look like when you're actually in the street or face to face with a police officer or trying to talk with someone at a meeting? And as Jim said, one of the most revolutionary things you can do is to act from love, and recognizing that people, whether they say they act from love or not, really only are willing to risk things for things that they think are important, and usually that's because it's something that they love. And so those of us who take action are often in touch with some really basic element that we want to protect, whether it's our children, our neighborhoods, our families, our communities, the environment. But having and helping people get in touch with that core understanding and having that desire to protect it, or the anger about it being taken away or destroyed, can help people enter into the movement and help people figure out how to make a strategy from the vision of a better world that they have. And joining, if you take anything away from today, it's about the fact that we can actually work together to make ourselves stronger and more effective activists and build that beloved community, in the words of Martin Luther King and others, or to use whatever language that speaks to you for building the world that you want to see and modeling that behavior on the path to winning. And that's one of the reasons why nonviolent movements are twice as successful as violent movements, because it encourages us and allows us to practice the movement, in the movement, the world that we want to see happen in the future, overcoming sexism, racism, patriarchy, and the like. And so really put that out there as a way to think about the work that we do today. So do you want to add anything else, or should we go to the closing exercise? We'll do closing. So we want to take just a minute, and we talked a little bit about how important listening was for the work that we do as the first line of de-escalation even. And we're going to ask you all, and we can put the slide up. We're going to ask you to turn to somebody that's sitting near you, hopefully one person, so you can do it in pairs. And we're going to give you a minute, one person at a time, a chance to talk about, if you were living to 100 or somewhere down the road and you looked back on this time right now, I'd like you to talk about, you know, what was keeping you from actually fully stepping into your potential? What's keeping you from taking action right now? What are the fears? What are the things that you need to overcome to do something? And talk about what it was that you actually did in 2017 that allowed you to step into your power, that allowed you to become more involved in transitioning or transforming the world into the place that we all want to call home, that takes care of everyone. So people could find partners, and we're going to give a minute and a half or so for the first person to talk. The second person can listen. We'll give you a chance to reflect back what you hear. And then, of course, we'll switch so that the other person can talk, and then you can reflect back what you heard. Everybody ready? Can you find yourself a partner? And one person in each partner, raise your hand so we know who's going to talk. Here we go, one person. Okay, so go ahead and get up, move around, find yourself a partner if you need it. There's a question for information up there. And go ahead and answer these questions. 54. Great. So if you can now, the people who are listening, if you can take a moment, and the people who are listening can now take 30 seconds to reflect back what you heard your partner say. Go ahead and reflect back what you heard. Great. So if you can sort of close up your reflection, and thank you for that, there we'll now have an opportunity for the second person to share their answers to these questions. When you're looking back on your life, what were you afraid of, and what did you do to overcome your fears and be more active? So go ahead, second person, you have a minute or so. All right, so if you could say your last words as the speaker, that would be great. And in a moment, we're going to have a chance for the person who was listening to reflect back what they heard you say. So go ahead, you have about 30 seconds to reflect back what your partner said. Take a few. Okay, so go ahead and thank your partner and close out your reflections. And you can put your hand in the air and we can focus back to the whole group quietly. Here we go. So I'm just going to yell out a question for all, you all beautiful people. How did that feel? How did that feel? It felt good, right? And one of the reasons it feels good is because, as we talked about, there's so much power in listening, right, in actual connections with people. If anybody wants to share something that they heard, if it's okay with your partner, something that your partner said that resonated with you, or something that you're going to do to, you know, address your commitment, if you will, that would be great. Chelsea's got the mic again. She's running around. So she'll take a few questions, a few comments about this. Oh, it's not working? Oh, yeah. Oh, it is now. Yep.
My partner told me something that I think is really important, is that to not splinter ourselves, that there are the forces that try to splinter us are diminishing our energy and our power, that we have to start putting, we have to start being stop being so critical of each other and the past. Who did what in the past? To go forward with Hillary, Bernie, the people that everything that happened, you know, you. In this recent past, in this election, because we're just going to start beating each other up, and we will lose the focus of what so desperately we need to unite on.
Thank you. Somebody else who wants to hear something that. That you resonated, if we heard something that was surprising, you can also let us know, but it's something that was that you found interesting. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Pam, and I spoke with Ashley. And Ashley's a young lady that has always organized or worked in the background, But in 2017, she decided as a writer that she would step up and that she would write about and participate in the process of getting this information out. And I just want, and run for office. Woo! And that made me happy because, of course, Ashley's a woman. And I said to her that if we're not in the room, our voices aren't heard. And that speaks for every other minority, LGBTQ, or anyone else. If you're not in the room, your voice is not considered.
Thank you. Great. That's great. We'll take one other thought. There's one in the back.
Hey, I'm back. Jeremiah, I spoke with Lauren, and I found that we had a very similar problem. We're both writers and artists, and what she said was when she was working with people, there was a lot of toxicity within the group, and she wasn't allowed to thrive. So what I suggested is something I've actually needed to do because I'm a bit of an empath, so I know how artists are, and in general, what I said was that you should go inside yourself and kind of liberate yourself, and I wasn't as poetic when I said this to her, but basically, you should just go ahead and do that for yourself. So don't necessarily do it for other people. Do it for yourself and then share it, like you said, face-to-face. That face-to-face contact makes a big difference. And it helps me get throughout the day when I'm able to open somebody's mind on the bus that I'm next to or things like that. So, you know, that's going to keep your fight alive. And it'll help the other person as well.
Thank you. So this is really powerful. I hope that you take away also the power of listening and the power of establishing relationships with folks. Many people in the world do not actually have someone who will listen to them without, and let them talk and talk. I mean, lots of people do that. They pay $100 or whatever, and people will listen to them. But if we can put in place the compassion and the time and the effort into listening, it's a capacity that we all can improve on, and it's accessible to everyone. So I just put that out there as one of the ways we like to close this work. We hope that you've taken away inspiration and the understanding that you can build capacity for being more effective activists and stepping into risk in the future. Jim, do you want to add anything?
There's more activism in the United States than ever before in the last 40, 50 years, and more activism around many, many different issues. There are more people who are aware of discrimination, sexual assault, and the rest of it than ever before. And these issues were not live issues 40 years ago, maybe, let's say. I've been on college campuses off and on for a long time, and only in the last few years have women been objecting to sexual assault and harassment and intimidation on college campuses. And the college presidents now don't really know what to do about it. Because that's a huge issue. So the thing that we have to avoid is activism for activism's sake. Gandhi said that sometimes doing nothing is better than doing something that really doesn't make a difference in your life or in other lives or in the issue. And that's one of the reasons why I at least recognized across my own life that nonviolent struggle is the idea of human history that has ripened to the place that we need to learn to use it. And if we're going to have a world in the future, it will because millions of people decided that they are on the right track to be persons who love their life and love life itself, love their neighbors, love their children, and want to see the emphasis upon a different kind of future for them and for all people. So be bold and audacious. If you take care of the notion that nonviolence, soul force, is love in action, love in practice, and that through it, almost all human issues can be resolved on the side of a more positive world, a more positive life, and more positive people upon healing of the earth and healing of the human race. Nothing is more desperately needed, and nothing is more important for any human being than to be engaged in the future of life in the present age.
Woo! Perfect. So we're going to take this moment, I think, to close out. We're really glad that you all could participate. We hope that you'll go on to read and study and go to other workshops and trainings, because we just whet your appetite for more today. We're going to model a closing evaluation piece. I'm going to ask people to shout out maybe one word of something you're going to take with you from the last 3 hours that we spent together. What's one thing you're going to take with you? And it could be an adjective or an adverb or an actual physical thing, but go ahead, let's hear some shout outs from anybody. Love. We've got love, soul force, strategy, power. Yes, that's really great. So before we go outside, and the people who are tabling are still going to be there, I'm so excited, so make your movement match. We really want to thank again Claudia Bester and the Hammer Museum. We want to thank the Wiltern for hosting us and everyone who was involved for making this day possible. So thank you so much. We'll see you outside.
Thank you for being here.
It's great.